Hello everyone. The topic is management of a special child. The term special child or a disabled child, they are often referred for those who are impaired. Impaired can be, they can be physically impaired or they can be mentally impaired. And because of that, there is restriction to their daily activity in some or the other manner. So this becomes a special child. So this handicapped children, they can be broadly classified into two. That are the medically compromised and the developmentally disabled children. So they are the ones, they are considered as a special child. So WHO, that is World Health Organization, in 1981, they first started the medical services for such children, for such handicapped children. And after that, there are a number of specialists, dentists who are providing or who are willing to work for such specialized child. So what is handicapped child? So American Public Health Association, they define this handicapped child as a child who cannot, within the limits, they cannot play, they cannot learn, work or do things other children of his age can do. And he is hindered in achieving his full physical, mental and social potentialities. So the child who is handicapped, they cannot do like things other child of same age they can do. So this becomes a handicapped child. So they cannot play because they have some like, so they are handicapped. They have some physically handicapped problems. Because of that, they cannot play, or they are mentally retarded. Because of that, they cannot play, or they cannot learn, or they cannot work. So this becomes a handicapped child. So they can be mentally handicapped or physically handicapped. So there are like various classifications which were given, but the classification that you should know is the one which was given by Novak in 1976. So he classified the handicapped child into 9 categories. So he classified the first one. So the first category is the one which is physically handicapped. So it can be the child, he have polio. So that becomes a physically handicapped. Second is mental handicap. Mental is, there is mental retardation. So it is a mentally handicapped child. Third is a congenital defect. Congenital defect, the one which is present from birth. So that becomes a congenital defect. So it can be cleft palate or Fallot's teratology. So that is nothing but a congenital heart disease, which we have already seen in our 3rd year in general medicine. The next one is a convulsive disorder. So convulsive disorder, the example can be epilepsy. Then the communication disorders, if a child, he is deaf or he is blind. So that becomes a communication disorder. Next is a systemic disorder. Systemic disorder can be hemophilia or there is hypothyroidism. So that becomes a systemic disorder. Metabolic is, there is juvenile diabetes. So that is a metabolic disorder. Then osseous disorders are the rickets, osteopetrosis. So these are the osseous disorder, and the malignant one are the leukemia. So these are like the various disorders. So the Novak, he classified or he categorized it into this 9 groups. Now what is dentally handicapped? Now we have seen handicapped child in a general term. But what is dentally handicapped? So American Academy of Pediatric Dentistry in 1996, they defined dentally handicapped as a person, he should be considered dentally handicapped if the pain or infection or the lack of functional dentition, that is nothing but the missing teeth. So if there is lack of functional dentition, it affects any of the following. That can be, it is restricting. So that pain or that infection or that lack of functional dentition, it is restricting the consumption of the diet. Now, if the patient is having tremendous pain, because of that, he cannot eat properly. So it is restricting the consumption of diet, and that diet, it is adequate. So that diet, we know, we want all those nutrients for the normal growth. So the restriction of the consumption of the diet, which is adequate to support the normal growth and developmental needs. So in that case, it becomes a dentally handicapped person. Then the next can be, it delays or alters the growth and the development. Now, as I have said, nutrients, they are required, and we get the nutrients through eating, through diet. So if we cannot eat because of some problems, that can be a pain or infection or lack of dentition, and because of that, we cannot eat properly. And because of that, there is delay or there is alteration in the growth and development. So that person is considered as a dentally handicapped. Or there is inhibition of the performance of any major activity, that includes work, learning, communication and recreation. So if that pain, if that infection is so severe that the patient cannot perform the normal activities like the child, he cannot go to school because he's having so much of pain because of the infection. He cannot do the normal activities. He cannot play. So that is inhibiting the performance of his life activity, and that is considered as a dentally handicap. Starting off with the first one, that is the mental retardation. So mental retardation, it has been defined as the sub-average general intellectual functioning which originates during the developmental period and it is associated with the impairment in the adaptive behavior. And this definition, it was given by American Association of the Mental Deficiency. So now, what is this sub-average general intellectual functioning? Now, we all know about that intellectual question, that is your IQ. So now, in an average child or in an average person, the IQ level is 100. So if it is below that, so if the intellectual functioning is below average person, so that becomes a sub-average intellectual functioning. And this, it originates during the developmental period and it is associated with the impairment in the adaptive behavior. So adaptive behavior is the patient who is mentally retarded. He is not communicating with others. He is not living a normal life. So the daily living skills, they are hampered. Then he is not socially active. So those are your adaptive behaviors. There is impairment in that adaptive behavior. Now this mental retardation, it is also defined as the overall intellectual quotient, which is lower than 70. Now, as I have said, in an average patient or in an average person, the IQ, it is 100. So if it is less than 70, it is mentally retarded. So if the IQ level is 80 or 90, he is not considered as mentally retarded. If it is only like lower than 70, then it is mentally retarded. And it is associated with the functional deficit in the adaptive behavior, that are your daily living skills, social skills, or communication. So there is impairment in all these various factors in a mentally retarded person. Now there are three levels of the mental retardation. The first is the idiot. So the individuals whose development, it is arrested at the level of 2 years old only. So even if the patient is growing, but the mental age or the development of his brain is arrested at 2 years. The next is imbecile. So they are the individual whose development, it is equivalent to that of 2 to 7 years old, even at maturity. So even that patient's like age, he's growing. So he has matured in his chronological age, but the mental age, it is equivalent to 2 to 7 years. And the next one is moron, in which the individual whose mental development, it is equivalent to that of the 7 to 12 years of age, even at the maturity. So even that patient is growing, but the mental age of that patient, he is at like 7 to 12 years only. So this is the classification of the mental retardation. So first is the degree of the mental disability. So it is mild, moderate, severe, it is profound. Now, what are the IQ levels? So it is mild. Now, we have seen if mental retardation is below 70. So mild is when the IQ level or the IQ range, it is between 50 to 70. Moderate is when it is between 35 to 50. And severe is when the IQ level, it is below 35. So that becomes a severely mentally retarded patient. Now, how is the communication skill in a mild patient? So they speak well. So they can speak well for the communication needs. Now the moderate one, they have vocabulary to communicate at the basic level. So they can communicate at a very basic level. They cannot understand very high terms, or they cannot understand very, like, if you're talking too fast or you're talking like a very different words which they cannot understand. So they can like communicate at a very basic level. And in severe, there is little or there is no communication skill. Like they cannot even talk. So severe ones are the patient who cannot talk properly. So the mentally retarded patient, they cannot talk if they are severely retarded. Now the practical description is the mild patient, they can be educated. The moderate ones, they are trainable and they can perform self-help skills. And in severe one, there is consistent custodial care which is required in a severe ones. The special requirements for the dental care in mild is, now you're treating them as the normal child. As you're treating the normal child, you're treating the mild cases of the mentally retarded patients also as them only. But in them, in mild, like if there's a mild retardation, in that you can need mild sedation or there is nitrous oxide, oxygen, analgesia. Now you have to keep this in mind. that this patient, the mentally retarded patient, they are very unstable, they do not cope, they aren't cooperative, then they are moody. So the mood, they, like at one point they are cooperating, they are good, but suddenly like the other point they are not cooperating at all. So this is the point that you need to remember in like when you're treating a mentally retarded patient. Then you're treating them like a normal child only. But in such cases where they are uncooperative, they are not ready to cooperate to you. So in that case, you need sedations for them. The mild one, in mild also, you need mild to moderate sedations. And in severe one, there are these uses of restrain or positive reinforcement. Now, what are this restrain or positive reinforcement? So they are the method, or they are the behavior shaping or behavior management methods. Now, what are these behavior shaping and management? So this is a very important topic in your pediatric itself, in which like how you are changing or how you are managing the behavior of such children who are not cooperative. So that's like a very important thing. So this restraints and positive reinforcement, they are the methods. Now restraints are like when the patient, they are like tremendously uncooperative, they're not ready to cooperate, they're not ready to listen, like they're moving their hand, they're moving their legs, they're moving their like mouth, so they're not ready that you can do your work properly. So in that case, you're using restraints, like you're tying their like hands, legs with the help of, so there are various restraints which are used. There can be like restraints which are known as pedi wrap, or there are papo's board. So these all restraints you can study in behavior management. So these are the restraints in which you're like holding, or you're wrapping, or you're tying the hands and the legs of the patient so they're not moving them. And positive reinforcement is, so it is a method in behavior modification in which you strengthen the response by adding like pleasant stimulus after the behavior. Like for example, you praise the child, like if they allow you to do some work, so you're praising them, or you're giving some rewards to them. You're giving some stickers. So if they're allowing you to do something, then you praise them or you give some rewards so that they're allowing you to do the other works like easily. So that becomes a positive reinforcement. Now again, it is a type of a behavior shaping technique. So this is all about the classification of the mentally retarded. Now, what are the etiological factors for the mentally retarded patient? So the etiological classification, it is classified as prenatal, natal and postnatal. Prenatal can be some genetic disorders or diseases, or maternal and the fetal infection, or there is kernicterus. Kernicterus is nothing but the brain damage due to high level of bilirubin in the baby's blood. That is kernicterus. And there can be fetal alcohol syndrome. So these are the reason for the mental retardation prenatally. So natal ones are the birth injury. So birth injury, it can be common due to forceps delivery. Then infection, cerebral trauma, hemorrhage, anoxia, hypoglycemia. So these are the natal etiological factors. And postnatal can be cerebral infection, then cerebral trauma, poisoning cerebral vascular accident, post-immunization, encephalopathy, and malnutrition. So these all are the etiological factors. You need to just remember the names of them. If you get a question on mental retardation, then you have to write the etiology in that manner only. The oral manifestation of a mentally retarded child. There are advanced cases of baby bottle tooth decay, early childhood caries, or prescription medication induced decay. So this is a baby bottle tooth decay in which there is prolonged feeding with the bottles. The next is there is altered salivary flow and the tooth decay. Then there is placating tooth decay. So placating is nothing but when you're using or when you're decreasing the angle level. Now this specially, like the special needed child, they are very unstable. So because of that, they can get angry very easily. And to reduce that anger, what usually the parents do is they give them some chocolates or they give them some sweets. And because of that, there is higher incidence of tooth decay. So this is known as placating tooth decay. Then there is malocclusion, fractured and non-vital teeth. And there can be soft tissue complication and bruxism. Then there is major loss of tooth structure, because in the patient with special care needs, so a mentally retarded, so a patient with mental retardation, they are very, like they are very prone to traumatic injuries, and because of that there can be like major loss of the tooth structure, and because of that there is eventual extraction of it, and it can affect developing speech pattern. And there is unmonitored food consumption as they are mentally retarded. Then there is abnormal jaw development, there is marked alteration in the mastication, there is poor aesthetics, there is poor dental hygiene, and because of that there is plaque accumulation, and which leads to gingivitis, and there is intense halitosis. And the other oral manifestation is there is gingival overgrowth, there is this gingival enlargement which you can see in a mentally retarded patient. Now the main important part is the dental treatment of the child with mental retardation. Now how are you going to treat a child with mental retardation? So first and the most important is the behavior management techniques. Now as I said, there are many behavior management techniques. So if you want that I should explain about this behavior management techniques, then do let me know about it too. Then I'll explain, like I'll make a video on this, like what all are the behavior management. So behavior management, as I said, they can be restraints. So if the patient, he is like very uncooperative, and in that case you can use restraints, or you can use, so there are basically behavior management, it can be done in two ways. They can be pharmacological and non-pharmacological. Pharmacological is when you're giving sedations, or in severe cases even you can give general anesthesia. So these are like the behavior management techniques. And non-pharmacological, like there's a very big group of like techniques in this behavior management. So first and the most important is you're managing the behavior of the patient. The next is the dental procedure. It must be explained slowly, simply, and repetitively. So the procedures. So first we have seen, now we have to explain the procedures to them like very slowly, because they cannot understand properly what you're speaking. And you have to explain the procedures in the most simple way that you can. And then you have to repetitively tell what you exactly are going to do, because they cannot like remember the things well. The next is you have to give only one instruction at a time. You're not bombarding a patient with many things. You are telling the patient with mental retardation like a one instruction at a time. Then you're going to reward the patient with compliments after each procedure. So you're complimenting it, you're rewarding that patient with many things. Like you can give the pat on the shoulder, or you can give stickers, pencils, anything. Whatever it can be, you're rewarding the patient so that the patient, he allows you to do the further procedure. Then you're going to actively listen to the patient. So people with mental retardation, they often have trouble with communication. So if the patient, he's trying to tell you something, so you're going to actively listen. You're not going to ignore that patient. You're going to actively listen to it. The next, the visit, it should be short, as like they're unstable. So they cannot sit for a longer time at a single place. So because of that, the visit, it should be short. There should be minimal new procedures which are introduced at each appointment. So it's not like you're introducing many things at a time. You're minimally, you're introducing some new procedures at every appointment. Because if you're like giving or you're showing many things at a time, then the patient with mental retardation, he won't even let you do that work. So you're going to like introduce some new procedures like slowly. Then gradually you're going to progress to the more difficult procedures. So slowly you're going to progress to the difficult procedures. First you're going to start with normal cleaning, then normal fillings, then you're going to go with the anesthesia, root canals, like gradually, slowly. You're not directly starting with root canal with such patients. The next is we must learn from the patient or the guardians about the patient's habit. So if the patient, he has some habits, so you have to be aware about it. You have to like ask about all these habits to the parents or the guardians. Then comprehensive word or the gestures are used to facilitate our work. Then before using physical restriction on patient, sustainability, it must be considered for each case and with the parental or the guided consent. So if you are going to use restraints, so if the patient, he is uncooperative, severely uncooperative, in that we are using restraints. But this restraints, it should be used depending on the suitability, how the patient is suitable to it. After using restraint, if the patient, he started crying so much that like eventually you can't do that work. So it should be dependent on the suitability, and even you should ask about the consent of the parents. It should not be like the parents or the guidance, they are unaware about it. So there should be awareness about this using of this physical restraint to the parents. Then we must consider the patient's behavior, his age, and the type of the dental treatment which is needed. Then we may utilize elements of the partial or the total restriction or the collaboration of the two or three helpers. So we must like consider about these things also. Like we can use restriction, as I said, physical restrictions, or you can ask for help. You can ask the parents itself. You can ask the assistants that you are holding the hands and the legs of the patient. So this is the collaboration of two, three helpers. Then sedation techniques, it can be used such as oral premedication. So it can be used in mild to moderate cases, sedations can be used. Then general anesthesia, as I said, if the patient is like very uncooperative, in that case, you need to use general anesthesia. So general anesthesia, it should be used only in the cases where physical restriction or behavior management or conscious sedation, they have failed. So as I said, if the patient has started crying more, if you're using physical restrictions. So in that cases, you need to keep in mind that you have to do the treatment under general anesthesia. The next is, with adequate preparation, the dentist and the staff, they can provide a valuable service. Now, by thoroughly understanding the patient's degree of mental retardation and the ability, and by the exercising practices and by exercising patience and understanding, the dentist, they should have not significant problem in delivering the dental care. So everything, so the treatment, it can be done properly if you have like a well thorough knowledge about the condition of the child. So there should be adequate preparation of the dentist and the staff regarding the condition of the child. So this is the dental treatment which is considered in the case where the child, he is mentally retarded. What is this IQ test? So now we have seen that a person, he is said as a mentally retarded if the IQ level is below 70. Now, how are you determining that IQ which is below 70 or what it is? So this determination of the IQ, it is done through this IQ test or through this various scales which are given. So the scales which are given are the Standard Bennett, Kettle, Wechsler and Wechsler adults. So this scales, you're determining the IQ level of the patient. Now, if you want to know what the scales are, because like generally in your exams, no one is going to ask you about this like explanation of the scales. But still, if you want to know about them, then do let me know. Like I can make a very short video on this. Like the Stanford Bennett, it has various factors. So basically it has five factors. Now, depending on that five factors, the IQ level, it is tested. Like what exactly the mental age of the patient is. So depending on that scales, we are seeing it. So the main thing that you need to remember is the standard formula. So a standard formula for computing a ratio of the IQ is, so IQ, it is computed as mental age upon the chronological age into 100. So if the chronological age is 10 years, and if through the scale you get the mental age also as 10 only, so that becomes like the IQ is equal to 100. So that is an average age. So that is an average IQ level for that particular 10 years age. Now, if the IQ, it is above 130, so that is considered as very superior. And this very superior case was with Einstein. So the Einstein's IQ, it was above 140. So in that case, if the IQ, it is above 140 or it is 140, so that person, he is considered as a God-gifted. So Einstein was amongst them. So in which the IQ of Einstein was 140. So this is a formula that you should remember. And WHO, they recommended the division of the mentally subnormal into three groups, that is mild, moderate and severe. So mild is when the IQ is 50 to 69, moderate is 20 to 49 and severe is 0 to 90. And in this case, if the mental age of the patient is 8 to 12 years, irrespective of his chronological age. So even if the patient is 30 years, 40 years, but the mental age of the patient is 8 to 12 years, it is considered as mild. If it is 3 to 7, he is considered moderate. And if the age, mental age of the patient, it is 0 to 2, then he is considered severe. And this is just an example of how the Stanford Bennett intellectual scale of the test, it goes. So like there are various forms in this Bennett Stanford intellectual scale. So what are the important tips that you should keep in the mind when you are working with a special child? So first is you should interact properly. Then next is you're observing the patient properly, because the mentally retarded or special child, they won't say everything directly verbally. So you have to observe them properly. The next is you're going to use common sense for all the problems. Next is be flexible, because the special care child, they cannot like accommodate every and every like each and every situations. So they want things according to themselves only. So because of that, you should be flexible so that you can do the work properly. The next is be consistent. So if you set some rules, so be consistent about that only. The next is you should use visual, auditory or tactile cues. Tactile cues can be you're gently touching the patient's shoulder or you're offering a blanket. So these are the cues. The next is you should have a plan and a backup plan. It's not always in the cases of special need child. So it's not always that what you have decided, it will go like that only. There can be many problems that can be created because that patient, that special needed child, they are very unstable. They won't cooperate in each and like they won't cooperate with each and every moment. So there can be some problems that you have thought about it. So for that, you should also have some plan B, or even you should have plan C at that case. The next is be positive. So a positive attitude is the single most important quality for anyone who works with the children with a special need. So in this cases, you have to be very calm. You should be positive because you are treating a special need child. They are not like the normal ones. So you should be very like soft spoken. You should not get irritated and you should be positive. So you are handling the special care child with like the utmost care that you can. That was all about the mental retarded child. Now in the further videos, I'm going to cover about the child autism, that is the autistic child, then about the Down syndrome, epilepsy, then there can be like I'm going to cover about cerebral palsy, then like if the patient he have visual impairments, deafness. So these all are the various considerations in the special needed child, which I'm going to cover like what are the treatment modalities for all of them. And this was all about your mental retardation. Thank you so much.